Good morning, dear students. So in continuation, like we have discussed palm, we have finished the muscles of palm, and we have also discussed about the palmar aponeurosis and fibrous flexor sheaths. So in continuation, now we are going to discuss spaces of hand. So what are the various, what is spaces of hand? Now, because we have studied the muscles in detail, like for example, towards the thumb, I said this is thenar eminence, and towards the little finger, we have hypothenar eminence. So like if you observe, so in the thenar eminence, we have the thenar muscles, and in the hypothenar eminence, we have hypothenar muscles. Between the metacarpal bones, we have the interossei. From the palmar aspect, palmar interossei, from the dorsal aspect, dorsal interossei. Between the tendons of flexor digitorum profundus, we saw lumbricals. This is the short review. Now, if you observe, between these muscles, we are finding some free space, right? This whitish area behind background, this white area, where between the muscles, some empty space is present. So these empty spaces are nothing but the spaces of hand. So like that, we have many spaces. Like if it is seen towards the medial aspect of the hand, you call it as mid-palmar space, and away from the midline towards the thumb, you call it as thenar space. So mid-palmar space, thenar space, many other spaces in the finger, pulp space of finger also we have. The difficulty with these spaces is, suppose if there is any infection, this infection easily spreads, and you will see it leads to the formation of pus. Okay, and there will be severe pain and swelling because of the presence of these empty spaces. Okay, so these are the potential spaces where the infection can occur, and they become a place where the bacteria can easily multiply and can cause infection. So now the spaces of hand are of clinical significance because they may become infected, and in consequence, they become distended with pus. That's the reason the spaces of hand are important. Again, spaces of hand also can come as an essay question, or one of the space may come as 5 marks or 3 marks question. So if you find empty spaces in the palm, you call it as palmar space. So like that, we have mid-palmar, thenar and space, and pulp space of finger. I will elaborate each and every space. This is only the list. On the dorsum of the hand, we have dorsal spaces like dorsal subcutaneous space and dorsal subaponeurotic space. So in the forearm, we have space of perona, the synovial tendon sheaths of second, third and fourth digits, the ulnar and radial bursae. So we will discuss each and every topic under each heading in detail. Now, if I just want you to understand this picture, which looks like a Telugu letter A. Okay. Now see here, Telugu alphabet. Now see here. So this eminence, what you are finding is the thenar eminence, where you have thenar group of muscles. This is hypothenar eminence. This is the picture which has been taken like this. That means this is the transverse section of palm. Okay, I told you a letter like Telugu letter, we have alphabet, that is A. Like this, just to emphasize the fact how the picture has been taken, it becomes more easy for you. Okay, see here. Now what is the layout of things you have? First thing you have there is skin, right? Below the skin, we have the superficial fascia. Then we have deep fascia. Modification is palmar aponeurosis. Below that, we have the tendons of flexor digitorum superficialis. Below which, we have the tendons of flexor digitorum profundus. In between the profundi muscles, we have lumbricals. Then between the metacarpal bones, we have on the palmar aspect our palmar interossei, and from behind you have dorsal interossei, right? So this is how is the layout of structures. Now let us see with this picture, which is much more clearly defined here. Now these are the thenar group of muscles, these are the hypothenar group of muscles. The first line what we are seeing is skin. Below skin, this yellowish thing is the palmar aponeurosis. Below palmar aponeurosis, you are actually finding the arterial arch, which you will learn in the next class after palm. So superficial and deep palmar arches. Okay, those are the networks of blood vessels formed by the continuation of radial and ulnar arteries. Okay, below this we also have the nerves which supply these muscles. Those are nothing but the digital nerves, branches of the median and ulnar nerve. Okay, as you go down, superficial ones are the tendons of flexor digitorum superficialis. Below this we have tendons of flexor digitorum profundus. Between the tendons of flexor digitorum profundus, these are lumbricals, these like brown structures which are shown. Okay, then these are metacarpal bones. We need to count them from thumb, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, right? So from the palmar aspect, the names of the interossei are palmar interossei, and when you see from behind, these are dorsal interossei. So in the Roman number, whatever is given is dorsal interossei, and in the numericals 1, 2, 3, 4, which is written, that is palmar interossei. As you go down, you are digging the palm one by one, you are removing the structure and you are exploring the palm. Once you remove all these, again you will find there is one empty space, you call it as dorsal subaponeurotic space, which you can actually scroll your skin over the metacarpal bones. That empty space is nothing but dorsal subaponeurotic space. Okay, then as you just go much more behind, below this like aponeurotic sheath, you have the dorsal subcutaneous space. Okay, then again, see, this is the dorsum of the skin of the dorsum of the hand, okay, below which you have the superficial fascia, okay, below which you have this space, that is the dorsal subcutaneous space. Okay, so like that you have below the aponeurosis we have dorsal subaponeurotic space. Below skin is subcutaneous, and below aponeurosis is subaponeurotic space. So now, if you remember, while discussing this palmar aponeurosis, I told you palmar aponeurosis is a triangular structure, and I told you underneath it is just sending the intermuscular septa. Now, thumb is the lateral aspect of the hand, little finger is the medial aspect of the hand. That's the reason the septum, which is extending from the lateral aspect, you call it as lateral intermuscular septum. This septum, okay, this is lateral intermuscular septum, and in between you are finding one line. This one is intermediate muscular septum. Now, more towards the midline, this is the medial intermuscular septum. So how many lines do we have now? 1, 2, and 3, right? So towards the thumb you call it as lateral intermuscular septum, and more or less in the midline you have the intermediate intermuscular septum, and medially towards the hypothenar muscles we have the medial intermuscular septum, which are actually nothing but the extensions of the facial components from the under surface of the palmar aponeurosis. This green line is actually palmar aponeurosis. Now, with the help of these three intermuscular septa, we are finding two spaces are formed. Like, for example, between the lateral intermuscular septum and the intermediate intermuscular septum, you are finding a space, more or less a triangular space. This space is towards the thumb, hence it is named as thenar space. Thenar space. Now, again, you are finding between these four boundaries, again, this space is again seen. So much of white area, right? Okay, where you have the superficial palmar arch, tendons of the flexor digitorum superficialis, tendons of flexor digitorum profundus, between which you have lumbricals. Apart from that, whatever empty space is there between the medial palmar septum and intermediate palmar septum, this empty space in the middle of the palm, it is called as mid palmar space. So these are the two very important spaces we have in palm, which may be asked as separate questions. Okay, so thenar space and mid palmar space. Okay, now if you see from the dorsum of the hand, the dorsal aspect, below the skin you have this subcutaneous space. This green thing is the aponeurosis. Below the aponeurosis you have dorsal subaponeurotic space. Okay. So how many spaces you have learned now? The four names you have learned. Okay. See, middle of the palm is mid palmar space, and towards the thumb is the thenar space. Below the skin of the dorsum of the hand is dorsal subcutaneous space. Below the aponeurosis, we have dorsal subaponeurotic space, right? Okay. Now let us define in words. So this thing is completely the palmar aponeurosis. From the palmar aponeurosis, we are just finding the extension of certain septa deep into the palm. This is lateral palmar septum, this is intermediate palmar septum, and this is medial palmar septum. So like the central hollow, this one is the central hollow of the palm between the thenar and hypothenar eminences. Deep to long flexor tendons and lumbricals, there lies a space that is nothing but the central palmar space. Okay, nothing but. Okay, then overall, this whole thing is the central palmar space, where we have medial palmar septum, lateral palmar septum. Okay, with the help of this intermediate fibrous septum, this has been further subdivided into, towards the midline, you call it as mid palmar space, and towards the thumb, you call it as the thenar space. So thenar space is laterally, and towards the little finger, we have the mid palmar space. And of course, counting is always from the thumb. I have been repeating this so many times. Okay, counting is always from the thumb side. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Though little finger is medial side, right? So like that, if you just observe the palm, towards the thumb, we have thumb thenar space, TNT, right? Thenar eminence, thumb, and the thenar space. Like that, you can remember. And middle of the palm, more towards the little finger, you have mid palmar space. Okay. Now, in order to understand the boundaries, we need to know certain palmar creases. Because when you talk about mid palmar space and thenar space, you will come across certain terms like, see, this is distal wrist crease. Especially, we will come across this name. This is distal palmar crease. Okay, distal transverse palmar crease, and this is proximal transverse palmar crease. You can observe these creases in your own hand. Okay, distal palmar crease and proximal, the one which is near to the place of origin. Shoulder joint is the place of origin, and this line is like comparatively close in distance to the shoulder joint. That's the reason it has been named as proximal, and away from this line you call this as distal, because these are found in the palm. They have named as proximal palmar crease and distal palmar crease. Okay, if you consider these as digits, this is proximal digital crease, middle digital crease, distal digital crease. Okay, so these are the creases which we need to understand when we are doing these boundaries of mid palmar and thenar spaces. I'll take you back to this picture if required once we move. I hope you thoroughly understood this picture. Pause the video, try to listen again and again so that you understand, because one exposure of the topic, it may be difficult for you to retain everything. Just try to repeat and revise. So this is a very simple nutshell type of presentation of both the spaces, mid palmar space and thenar space. So all these boundaries are given. I told you the spaces of palm can come as an essay question for 15 marks, or mid palmar space can come for 5 marks, or thenar space also can come for 5 marks question. I just kept this picture, which has been already explained, in order to make your understanding simple. So this larger space, whatever we are finding towards the little finger, more towards the midline, you call it as mid palmar space. The shape of this space is roughly triangular when you see in the cadaver while doing dissection. Situation, it is situated in the inner half of the hollow of the palm, right? Extent. Proximally, I'll take you the proximal and distal things. See, this is our mid palmar space. Proximally is this distal wrist crease, and distally it is distal palmar crease. So this is the proximal boundary and this is the distal boundary. Okay. So proximally, the distal margin of flexor retinaculum, also you can tell, distally distal palmar crease. Okay. communication. Proximally, when you just observe, like there is a space in the forearm also, which is called as forearm space of Parona. So this mid palmar space is proximally communicating with the forearm space of Parona. Okay, that's what is written here. Proximally, it is communicating with forearm space of Parona. Okay, facial sheets I have discussed in my previous class. So distally, it is continuous with the facial sheets of third and fourth lumbricals. Okay, so third and fourth lumbricals. So distally, this mid palmar space is in continuation with. Okay, then posteriorly, you are finding, see, now what are the other boundaries we have? See, anteriorly, see, this is our triangular space, mid palmar space. Anteriorly, are you not finding these tendons? 1, 2, 3. These are the tendons of which muscles anteriorly? This is the flexor digitorum superficialis, I said. Below which we have flexor digitorum profundus. In between them, these muscles are lumbricals. So flexor tendons of third, fourth, and fifth digits. And in between that, you are finding second, third, and fourth lumbricals. Okay. So this line is palmar aponeurosis. So this is anterior extension of this space, mid palmar space. This is our mid palmar space, and this is the anterior boundary. This is anterior boundary. Below this space, just if you understand this picture posteriorly, we know these are the interossea muscles, and this green line is the fascia covering the interossea muscles and also these metacarpal bones. That's how posteriorly what is written here, fascia covering the interossea and also the metacarpals. Now, laterally, I told you the lateral extension of this mid palmar space would be this. So what is the name of this septum I gave you? I told you this as intermediate septum, which is also, like it is written laterally, it is intermediate palmar septum. Now, medially, what septum do we have? I already told you it is medial palmar septum. Okay. In case if there is any infection of this mid palmar space, then we need to give an incision either third or fourth web space. I'll show you. See, this is third web space. This is fourth web space. Either you give incision here or give incision here and then drain the pus. In the first picture, we have seen this is how the mid palmar space is infected. Lot of pus was collected. You need to give an incision in the web spaces so as to express the pus, so as to treat it and give good antibiotics. Then automatically the infection will be cleared. Hope you understood. So that is, incision is either web space in the sense, again I will tell you, see, this is the, again you just start counting from the thumb. This is the first web space between the thumb and the index finger. Then this is the second web space between the index and the middle finger. This is the third web space between the middle and the ring finger. This is the fourth web space between the ring and little fingers. That means 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay, so these are nothing but web spaces. So you are opening third or fourth web space in order to express, in order to remove the pus which is collected if there is any infection. That's what is called as drainage. Okay, that is all about mid palmar space. This space we have studied. Once you thoroughly know about mid palmar space, I have put separate pictures also. Again, it is nothing but the same what is given in the tabular form. So it is more or less a triangular space. In front you have the palmar aponeurosis, superficial palmar arch. These are the flexor tendons. Okay, and in between you also have the lumbricals, right? Behind, we have seen the deep, dense fascia which is covering the interossea of metacarpal bones of third and fourth spaces. Okay, laterally, we have the intermediate fibrous septum, and medially, we have the medial palmar septum, right? These are the two septa. So, proximally, it is in continuation with the flexor retinaculum. It is closed by the attachment of the parietal layer of ulnar bursa. I will tell you what is this ulnar bursa as we proceed. Okay, so sometimes this mid palmar space may be in communication with forearm space of peroné. In such cases, if there is any infection in mid palmar space, it is this infection is spreading to forearm space of peroné. Okay, now see here, this is you are finding the ulnar bursa. Okay, and this is peroné space. These are all digits, isn't it? Phalangeal bones. This is the metacarpal bone, right? This is our mid palmar space. Actually, it is closed by the attachment of the ulnar bursa. But sometimes, see, because ulnar bursa is closed, this is also closed. But sometimes, if there is any communication, you will see the infection from the mid palmar space may spread into the forearm space of peroné. Okay, that is. This is all closed area, parietal layer of ulnar bursa. This is the floor of carpal tunnel. Now, mid palmar space. This is our mid palmar space. These are the extensions. These outpouchings, they look like diverticula. I already told you these are the web spaces of fingers along the third and fourth. Okay, that is like along the facial sheaths of third and fourth lumbrical muscles. Distal extension. So suppose if there is any infection in this mid palmar space, because it's a closed space, so infection of the palmar space, loss of normal concavity is not there. It looks convex now because of the collection of pus. There will be lot of pain, which is called as tenderness of the central palm. Okay, then pain with movement of third and fourth digits, because what do we have there? Just now I told you the facial sheaths are in continuation with the third and fourth lumbrical muscles. That's how these third and fourth digits, if the person moves, there will be severe pain. Now, how to treat it? The pus is, I told you, these are the web spaces, right? The third and fourth. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. The last one will be like this side also, we can give incision. So pus drained by splitting the web between third and fourth or fourth and fifth digits and exploring the lumbrical canal. Okay, then so that finishes the mid palmar space. Okay, so once we are done with this, let us see the thenar space. So we know it lies on the lateral part of the palm and the shape is like a triangle. Now, before I go like to this again, it's better we go with a larger size image. This one, it becomes quite easy for you to understand. So this is thenar space now towards the thumb. So again, now see, the medial boundary will be the intermediate septum, right? Lateral boundary will be the lateral intermuscular septum. This is anterior boundary where you have skin, superficial fascia, deep fascia and palmar aponeurosis. And here you will see the digital vessels and nerves and the tendons of the flexor pollicis longus and the flexor tendon of index finger. In the sense, flexor digitorum superficialis and profundus first lumbrical. This is all forming anterior boundary of this thenar space, right? So the posterior boundary of the thenar space would be the, like you are finding the interossei muscles, right? The first and second palmar and the dorsal interossei and the thick facial septum, which is the thick aponeurotic sheet, which is covering these interossei and also the metacarpal bones, right? So this is the posterior boundary of thenar space. Then proximally again, you will have the these things again. So you have the flexor retinaculum and distally, you will see this proximal transverse palmar crease. Okay, if you understand this picture, automatically you will write everything. Okay, now let us see with the help of this picture now. Table and picture I kept simultaneously for your better understanding. This thenar space towards the thumb, it is triangular. Situation is under the outer half of the palm. So proximally distal margin of the flexor retinaculum, same thing what we have studied for the mid palmar space. Distally, proximal transverse palmar crease. Just now I've shown you in the palm lines. Communication, proximally it is forearm space. Obviously the same thing aparona, then distally it is facial sheaths of the first lumbrical. Anteriorly we have short muscles of the thumb, flexor tendons of the index finger, first lumbrical and palmar aponeurosis. Posteriorly, understand, you will write in your own words like I was telling you. Posteriorly, we have the transverse head of adductor pollicis, then tendon of flexor pollicis longus, radial bursa and this one, lateral palmar septum. Medially is this one, intermediate palmar septum. Drainage, we have to give incision in the first web space. Okay, first web space would be this one, first web space. So that you are just removing the pus if there is any collection in the thenar space, right? That is thenar space. So thenar space, again, the same thing whatever I've explained is written here. See, this towards the thumb, you have the thenar space. In front, you have this palmar aponeurosis, superficial palmar arch. Muscles of thenar eminence, AFO, abductor pollicis, brevis, flexor pollicis, brevis, opponens pollicis, and adductor pollicis. I told you in the previous class. Then flexor tendons of the index finger. Then first and second lumbrical. Behind, we have adductor pollicis. Okay. Then laterally, thenar space, tendon of this becomes lateral, right? Flexor pollicis longus and its sheath separated from the thenar muscle by lateral palmar septum. Medially, this one, intermediate palmar septum. And then proximally, distal margin of the flexor retinaculum. Distally, it is extending as facial diverticula. This is one and this is two. Along the first and second lumbrical tendons of interdigital clefts. Okay, so this is the thenar space, what we are discussing now. So thenar space is also, it can get infected. So it is a closed space and infection of thenar space is also quite common. Okay, then the infection may reach the thenar space from infected radial bursa. Towards the thumb, we have radius bone and whatever bursa we have covering the tendons of the radial side, you call them as the radial bursa or the synovial sheets of the index finger. So if there is any infection in the thenar space, there will be pain and swelling of the thenar eminence and first web space, and the thumb is held in this abducted position. As you can see, it is away from the midline and it is flexed. Okay, that's the treatment. You have to give an incision at this point, A point. Incision in the first web space, that is the web space of thumb. Then pulp space of fingers, this itself may come as a 3 marks. It's also a most popular question we have from the university. So the spaces between the palmar skin and distal phalanges. Now see here, I will tell you, this is the proximal phalanx, this is middle phalanx, and this is distal phalanx. So this space, the distal phalanx, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is actually called as pulp space, pulp. Okay, the spaces between the palmar skin and the distal phalanx of all the fingers is pulp space. It lies distal to the fibrous flexor sheaths or the flexor tendons. Okay, so like the skin is, suppose this black line is skin. From the skin, you are finding there are these partitions coming. They are coming and getting attached to the bone, okay, periosteum of the bone. So that means skin is connected to periosteum of the distal phalanx by numerous black lines, which are nothing but radiating fibrous septa, which subdivides the space into number of tight compartments. Lot of fat will be there when you do the dissection. You will see lot of fat will be there in between these fibrous septa, okay. You will see the distribution of blood vessels as well. Okay, so pulp space, that is what is the distal pharyngeal space, is the pulp space, and the space is formed due to the extension of the fibrous septa extending from the skin to the periosteum of the bone. Between the fibrous septa, lot of fat is actually accumulated. Okay, that's what is pulp space. So that our fingers, they get like cushion like a feeling. We don't feel the pain when we do the movements, right? Okay, because of the presence of this lot of fat between the fibrous septa. Okay, these white areas are the fibrous septae, and this yellowish area, this is all fibrous fat. This is of course nail, this is dorsum of the finger, and this is the palmar aspect, and this is the pulp space. Okay, pulp space of the finger. Now, the distal fifth of the distal phalanx receives blood supply from digital arteries, okay, which are actually coming from the superficial and deep palmar arches, which you will be studying shortly. Okay, then, so if there is any infection of this pulp space, okay, this condition is actually called as Whitlow. So infection of the pulp space is common, and it is serious, commonly occurring in the thumb and index finger. So bacteria are usually introduced in the space by pinpricks or sieving needles. Okay, so what is the name of the infection? What do we call it as? I said Whitlow, also called as Phelon. So an abscess in the pulp space. So severe throbbing pain due to increased tension. Okay, so drained by lateral incision. Okay, that means suppose if you want to drain this pus, we have to give this lateral incision, opening all loculi and avoiding tactile skin sensation on the front of the finger. Like this, we have to take incision. Okay, so suppose if the person is neglecting and if he is not coming for the treatment, then gradually what happens? This blood vessel will not be giving any blood supply anymore to this distal phalangeal area, because of which this distal part of the phalanx will get degenerated. It's nothing but avascular necrosis of distal 4/5 of distal phalanx. Okay, so after that, I said on the dorsum of the hand, just below the skin, you can just scroll your hand over the dorsum of the hand, and you will reach into this space where you are able to freely move your skin. That is nothing but the dorsal subcutaneous space, which is found in the superficial fascia of dorsum of hand. It contains dorsal venous arch. Okay, the greenish blood vessels what you see over the dorsum of your skin is nothing but dorsal venous arch. We also find dorsal digital nerves. This we will discuss in detail when we are doing the dorsum of hand, when we are doing the venous drainage, right? So derived from superficial terminal branch of radial nerve and ulnar nerve. These things you will come across when we discuss radial and ulnar nerve in detail. For now, just try to understand, just below the skin of the dorsum of hand, we have a free space, which is nothing but the dorsal subcutaneous space, where we have the dorsal venous arch and the vessels and nerves. Okay, those are branches of ulnar and radial nerves. Okay, that is. Now, below this aponeurosis, we have the extensor tendons, okay, between which we have the aponeurotic sheet. Below this aponeurotic sheet, you have again one free space. You call it as dorsal subaponeurotic space. Okay, so between the deep fascia and dorsal surfaces of metacarpals and dorsal interossei, it contains the extensor tendons, it contains dorsal digital expansion, it contains dorsal carpal arch and their dorsal metacarpal branches. Okay, this is the blood vessels what is being discussed as a last point. Okay, in the next class you will understand it better then. So similarly, in the subaponeurotic space and subcutaneous space also infection can occur. Dorsal subcutaneous space and dorsal subaponeurotic space also may get infected. I told you in the forearm also we have empty space, which is called as forearm space or space of Purovna. So the facial interval underneath the flexor tendons of the front of the distal part of forearm. Okay. So, which is this violet in color, whatever is shown is Purovna space. Now, I want you to recollect like these four tendons, which are arranged in two rows, are nothing but the tendons of what? Flexor digitorum superficialis. Below which, you are finding deeper tendons. These are nothing but flexor digitorum profundus. And towards the thumb, what is the name of this blood vessel? Radial artery. Towards the little finger, what is the name of this blood vessel? Ulnar artery. Accompanying the ulnar artery, we have ulnar nerve. If you remember, along with the flexor retinaculum, carpal tunnel and all, below which you have median nerve. So this is median nerve, this is ulnar nerve. Think logically, you will understand everything. You know these are the bones, right? Towards the thumb, broader in the lower part is radius bone. Towards the little finger, this is ulna bone. So ulna, radius, this is our space below the long flexor tendons. This empty space is nothing but the space of perona or forearm space. Now let us see the boundaries. Once you understand this picture, you will write in your own words. You need not even read this, right? So what is the anterior boundary? This in above this violet area, that is above this perona space, we are finding the tendons of flexor digitorum profundus, above which we have the flexor digitorum superficialis. They are all enclosed by this bluish outline which is shown here, which is nothing but synovial sheaths. I told you in my previous classes also, the synovial sheaths are nothing but the protective synovial covering which are enclosing the synovial fluid, which will allow the free movement of these tendons while we perform various hand and forearm movements. Okay. So tendon of flexor pollicis is longus also, okay, surrounded by synovial bursa. Okay, for the flexor pollicis longus, the name of the bursa, a special name is given, that is the radial bursa. Okay, special name, that is the radial bursa. Rest all will be surrounded by this bursa, this synovial sheath, you call it as ulnar bursa. I want you to remember, surrounding the flexor pollicis longus, the name of the bursa is radial bursa. Surrounding the long flexor tendons of the superficialis and digitorum profundus, we have ulnar bursa. Ulna is medial side, and of course, radial bursa is lateral side. Okay, now we are talking about forearm space of perona, right? So proximally, it is in continuation with the intermuscular spaces of forearm. That means, what are the various muscles you saw in the forearm? Palmaris longus, flexor carpi, radialis, flexor carpi, ulnaris, isn't it? Pronator teres, flexor digitorum superficialis, flexor digitorum profundus, pronator quadratus, right? All those muscles, between those muscles, free spaces will be found, which are nothing but intermuscular spaces. That forms the proximal boundary. Distally, it is reaching the level of wrist. Laterally, outer border of forearm. Medially, inner border of forearm. Outer border is nothing but radial border. Medial border is nothing but the ulnar border of forearm. Okay, like this. This is the radial border. This is the ulnar border. Okay, that is the medial and lateral borders of the forearm space. Okay, this is the distal boundary, which is actually the distally reaching the level of wrist. Proximally, this is the proximal one, this is the distal one. In between the muscles, whatever space will be there, that is the perona space. Obviously, wherever we have free spaces, they are the potential spaces for infection. So perona space becomes infected from infected ulnar bursa. I told you ulnar bursa is nothing but the synovial sheath which is covering the long flexor tendons of the superficialis and profundus muscles. So if there is any infection here, you will see from the ulnar bursa, it easily spreads to the perona space. Okay, to drain the pus, vertical incision has to be given on the distal part of the forearm, this one, this point, here and here. Okay. Then we have web spaces also, web spaces. Okay, I told you between this, what are the web spaces? I said again, let me go, this is one web space. Between the digits, whatever spaces are there, you call them as web space, right? So like that, we have four subcutaneous web spaces. Okay, from its free margin, it extends at the level of metacarpophalangeal joint. What do we find in these web spaces? Lot of fat will be there, superficial transverse metacarpal ligaments, interossei muscles, lumbrical muscles, digital vessels and nerves. What you found between the four slips of palmar aponeurosis. Okay, this is suppose one slip between them, you have digital vessels and nerves. These are the transverse metacarpal ligaments. of course, wing tendons, if you remember, dorsal digital expansion, we will find the insertion of lumbricals and interossei. That point only is the web space. Okay. So now if you observe, this is towards the little finger. So this is our ulnar bursa covering the tendons of the flexor digitorum, superficialis and profundus. Flexor pollicis is longest. You are finding it is covered by a, again, synovial sheath, that is the radial bursa. Radial bursa, the synovial sheath of which tendon? Flexor pollicis longus. It forms the radial bursa. Okay, this is our radial bursa. Flexor pollicis longus tendon, like this. It is becoming in continuation with fibrous flexor sheath of the thumb. Okay, so superiorly it extends about 2.5 centimeters. This is the superior extent. 2.5 centimeters above the proximal to flexor retinaculum. Inferiorly, it extends up to the distal phalanx of the thumb. Radial bursa communicates with the ulnar bursa also sometimes at the level of wrist joint at about 50% of subjects. Not always, but in some 50% of subjects, there will be a communication between this radial bursa and ulnar bursa. What is the difficulty if there is communication? If there is any infection in radial bursa, it will spread to ulnar bursa. If there is any infection in ulnar bursa, it will spread to radial bursa. So of course, it is little unfortunate if there is any communication. Okay, infection. Now see here, radial bursa, we are talking about first, right? So the distal phalanx of the thumb is flexed and it becomes rigid if there is any infection. Patient cannot extend the thumb, although he can extend the other fingers normally. The hand is tender. Tender is, if it is painful on touch, it is called as tenderness. Okay. And if the treatment is delayed, obviously the infection may spread to ulnar bursa or it may spread to the tendon of flexor pollicis longus and it may get necrosed. It may shed off. Sloughing, that's what. Now next we have all long flexor tendons. They are surrounded by one more bursa, that is ulnar bursa. Okay. And this one, quite big in size. Common flexor synovial sheath, long flexor tendons of the flexor digitorum, profundus and superficialis. The beautiful picture which you can really understand is this, what I found, right? The upper two and lower two are the tendons of the flexor digitorum, superficialis. This is flexor digitorum, profundus. So all of them are enclosed by means, this is nothing but the ulnar bursa, right? So the long flexor tendons of the flexor digitorum, superficialis and profundus. Okay, of course, they also become continuous with the synovial sheaths of the digits deep to the flexor retinaculum. Then the sheath has any sheath, because it is a synovial sheath, it will have a parietal layer lining the walls of carpal tunnel, visceral layer which is closely applied to the tendons. I'll show one more picture to show the parietal and visceral layers. From the arrangement of sheath, it appears that the synovial sac has been invaginated by the tendons from the lateral side. I will show you one picture. See, this is the one. This is the thumb and it shows it has been invaginated from this direction. The outside layer is parietal layer, close to the tendon will be the visceral layer. It shows this bursa has been invaginating these tendons from the lateral side. Okay. That's the meaning. Then this is our ulnar bursa. Okay. So medial part, common sheath extends distally to the tendons of which finger? You are finding it is extended to little finger. Again, what is the difficulty? If ulnar bursa is infected, the infection will spread to little finger. Okay. So lateral part, this one is the lateral part, right? It stops on the middle of the palm. This one, this is the lateral part. Towards the thumb is lateral part, this one. Distal ends of the index, middle and ring fingers, they have their own digital synovial sheaths, right? This is the index finger, this is the middle finger, this is the ring finger. They have their own separate digital synovial sheaths. Now, infection of the ulnar bursa is most serious hand infection because it is enclosing all long flexor tendons. So obviously, all movements of the hand become restricted if there is infection in the ulnar bursa. Okay. patient's whole hand becomes swollen. That's what is edematous, and palm is moderately swollen, and there may be fullness immediately above the flexor retinaculum. Okay, the fingers actually become flexed, and we cannot extend it. Particularly the little finger we cannot extend, because we know ulnar bursa is in direct communication with this digital synovial sheath of little finger. Okay, and then so this is our ulnar bursa, this is the little finger. So these two sheaths project proximally a short distance above the flexor retinaculum, and they usually communicate with each other in the carpal tunnel here. That means this radial bursa and ulnar bursa, in case if they communicate, here they communicate. Okay, so that means if there is any infection in the radial bursa, it may go to the ulnar bursa as well. Okay, then we have, these are the synovial tendon sheaths. See here, this is like, suppose this is the tendon of flexor digitorum superficialis, this is the tendon of flexor digitorum profundus. I told you these tendons, they are invaginating the synovial sheaths laterally. The outside layer is the parietal layer, inside layer closely investing the tendons is the visceral layer of the synovial sheath. Between these parietal and visceral layers, you will find the synovial fluid. This is the proximal phalanx. This is the dorsum of the hand, where you have the dorsal digital expansion. Okay, the other structures, this is the fibrous flexor sheath, I told you in the previous class, which is extending almost from the palmar aponeurosis, enclosing all the digits, isn't it? So this is the digital synovial sheath is one, this one, pinkish one, this. So it contains tendons of flexor digitorum superficialis and profundus. This is our digital synovial sheath. Outside layer is parietal layer, inside layer is visceral layer, filled with synovial fluid. It gives lubrication. It allows free movements of these tendons. Okay? Okay. The sheath which surrounds the flexor digitorum extends downwards. That means it is moving towards the metacarpal bone. You can see here also. It is moving downwards. Okay? Then you can see this is one tendon. You can see this is the parietal layer. The one which is very close to the tendon is the visceral layer. This is the synovial cavity filled with synovial fluid. This can be the tendon of digitorum superficialis or profundus. This is the underlying bone. It is going and touching there. It has been discussed as the metacarpal, underlying metacarpal bone. Okay. And then apart from this, see, if you observe this, what is the name of this tendon, of which muscle is this? Flexor digitorum profundus, which gets inserted into the base of the distal phalanx. The one which splits into two and gets inserted into the either side of the middle phalanx is flexor digitorum superficialis. Now, in order to just suspend these tendons, again you are finding the synovial sheaths, okay, which are extending from these tendons to the periosteum of the bone. If this synovial sheath size is long, you call it as vincula longa, long. And if you find this synovial sheath size is small, you call it as vincula brevia. Brevis is small, longus is long. Okay? So these are the tendons, flexor tendons, digitorum superficialis, flexor digitorum profundus. These are our coverings, and these are the extensions. Synovial extensions moving towards the periosteum of the bone is nothing but vincula. Okay, vincula longa and brevia. These are actually 3 marks questions. Very popular question again. Okay, as you know, I told you, like this tendon, this dark green one is the flexor digitorum profundus. The one which splits is the flexor digitorum superficialis. We know these tendons are enclosed with synovial sheaths, and these synovial sheaths are extending towards the periosteum of the bone. If they are long in size, you call them as longa. If they are shorter, you call them as brevia. Now let us read the points given here. As the tendons lie within the fibrous flexor sheaths, these are connected to the phalanges by thin bands of connective tissue, which is called as vincula. In each digital sheath, these are, how many vincula are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? Okay, 2 are short. 1 and 2 are short, whereas 3 are long. Okay, then The short ones are called as Brevia and the longer ones are called as Vincula longa. So Vincula brevia are small triangular bands attached to the palmar aspect of the interphalangeal joint and distal part of the adjoining proximal phalanx. Okay, adjoining proximal phalanx. Then Vincula longa, three in number, right? Long and narrow bands which are extending from the dorsal aspect of the tendon to the proximal part of the like palmar surface of proximal phalanx. Okay, the blood vessels reach the tendons along with these vincula. Okay, so these are the vincula and these are the blood vessels. The blood vessels are reaching the tendons via these suspensions, vincula. Okay, that is the importance of this vincula. Now, tenosynovitis, what is this? It is an inflammation of the fluid-filled sheath. Just now we have seen the parietal and visceral layer which are formed by the synovial sheaths. So if this gets infected, that condition is tenosynovitis. Okay, it means the tendon which is surrounded by the synovial sheath got infected. ITC is always inflammation. Inflammation of the synovial membrane around the tendon is nothing but tenosynovitis. Symptoms, obviously there will be pain, swelling and difficulty in moving the particular joint where inflammation has occurred. Okay, flexor tenosyn, lot of inflammation, pain, redness, swelling you can see. Fusiform swelling you are seeing. Person will not be able to extend the digits, pain while he is doing extension. Tenderness will be there. Okay, so if there is any infection like that, then you have to give a transverse incision and just express the pus, remove the pus. Okay, crease of distal interphalangeal joint. Or we can also take this distal palmar crease. Okay, that is. There is a condition which is called as trigger finger, in which the finger gets locked in full flexion and it can be extended only if you give excessive voluntary effort with the help of other hand. So this condition is trigger finger. So when extension begins, it occurs suddenly with a jerk, as though it is a click. That's why it's called as trigger finger. So it is actually occurring due to localized thickening of long flexor tendons, preventing the movement of tendon. Like tenosynovitis just now we saw, right? Tenosynovitis. I told you there is an inflammation like that. Okay. So the tendon with its fibrous flexor sheath, it has undergone inflammation because of which there is tightening and the person will not be able to extend the digit. Okay, the tendon tries to move, its thickened part is caught in the osteofibrous tunnel. So incising the fibrous flexor sheath is the treatment. Okay, I hope you understood. So along with that, I will try to show you one dissected palm also. Yes. So in the previous class, already I have shown you this. Towards the thumb, we have the thenar group of muscles. Towards the little finger, we have hypothenar group of muscles. If you just move these muscles, you are finding some empty space. Towards the little finger, whatever space you are finding is the hypothenar space. And towards the thumb, this is the thenar space. The hypothenar space is nothing but mid palmar space. Okay, this is mid palmar space and towards the thumb is the thenar space. Okay, so if you just observe here, this areas is nothing but the pulp space of fingers we have. Pulp space of fingers. Okay, so of course the boundaries are discussed here. Okay, whatever, just I want you to understand these empty spaces are nothing but the spaces what you have between the long flexor tendons of flexor digitorum, superficialis, profundus, lumbricals. Okay, so that's it. So like that, you just try to read the things, try to understand. You will definitely understand. If you have any doubts, anytime you can just get back to me always. Okay, thank you.